Okay, so I talk of a qualitative analysis on a PDU model of neural networks. So it's a joint work with Maria Cáceres and Ricarda Schneider from oh, sorry.
Canada, Maria at least.
In Spain, sorry, I just it's a psychological. José Antonio Carrillo from Imperial College of London, Kota Ikeda from Japan, and Bonapertam and Didier Smets from Sorbonne University. Here are the general problematic that we have studied is to understand how collective neural dynamics can emerge from individual neurons. And in particular, we were interested of the emergence of periodic solutions. That is, when can we have observe synchronization of neurons? And we will try to answer this question with respect different aspects that that I will tell us after. And so in general, the aspects depend on the interesting dynamic of each neuron, the type of coupling, memory effects, delay of transmission. So in our study, we have chosen to describe the neuron via its action potential. So I think that everybody knows this, this picture, but I just show it to recall. So here we see the membrane voltage of the neurons. And if the membrane voltage reaches a value that we call the action potential, then there is a spike and the neuron discharge and can communicate with the other neurons. So our model is the following. So it's a model inspired from the integrate and fire model. And here, the neuron is described via its membrane potential. So V is assumed to live in minus infinity VF, where VF is the action potential. So this means that when the neuron reaches the value VF, the neuron discharge. And we also assume that when the neuron potential reaches the value VF, instantaneously, the membrane potential reset to the value VR. Okay. So with this, so there's several models proposed via this this kind of modelization, where the neuron is modeled by a leaky integrate and fire model. And we have studied the model proposed by Brunel and Hakim, which is the following one. So there are several notations that I will explain. So the part here is due to the leaky integrate and fire dynamic assumed on the neurons. Here it is a noise. And here it is the neurons that have discharged and come back to the value VR. Okay, and N of t is here the flux of neurons with discharge. So how we compute this N of t? N of t is equal to minus the derivative of p at VF t. Okay, so this means that in particular, we have the mass conservation with this. And with this flux of neurons, we can compute that we call the amplitude of stimulation that receive the neuron, or the, sorry, of the neuron at time t, and this amplitude of stimulation we call it x of t. And here we can observe that we have a parameter b, and this parameter b model essentially the strength of interconnection of the neurons. And this parameter have a sign. If b is strictly positive, we are in a excitatory networks, and when B is negative, we are in a inhibitory case. Okay, and if B equals zero, the equation is linear, and we have no interconnection between the neurons. So after I will show you a draw of the solution to see intuitively what happens. And so now the what we have chosen for x of t, there are several choices, but we have made two choices. The first one is the most natural, essentially x of t equal n of t. So this means that we assume that the amplitude of stimulation of the neurons is exactly equal to the flux of neurons with discharge. And so we will see that here the dynamic is very singular. So the second case that we have considered is a case where x of t is equal n of t minus d, where d is strictly positive. That is that we assume that we have a delay. That we have a delay on the equation. So the neurons must wait some time to receive the signal of the other neurons. So I will first begin to consider this case to understand what happens. And after, I will consider the last case with delay where we can see more complex patterns. So if we consider the case where x of t is equal to n of t, so this equation has been studied by many, many authors that I mentioned here. What happens? The problem is that the total activity of the networks acts instantaneously on the networks. And in particular, this will mean that if you are in the excitatory case, so that is B strictly bigger than zero, then you will have blow-up. So whatever the excitatory case, even if B is very small, you have blow-up, but not always. You have blow-up if you choose the solution, okay? The initial data, not the solution. And if B is large enough, you have always blow-up. However, as soon B is negative, so this means when you are in the inhibitory case, you can prove that you have global solution in the solution is well-defined. So more precisely, when you make numerical simulation, in the excitatory case, at least, you can see two types of dynamics. So it's not very complex. Either the solution converges to a stationary state, so it is the case here. So here it's the initial data. So the flux of neurons is equal to minus the derivative at this point here. And you see here that the dynamic, you have convergence to a stationary state. The other case is a case here, where here you see that you have an initial data which is like that, and the solution, so here VF here is equal to 2, VR you see here is equal to 1 in the simulations, and you see that you have blow up. So what does this mean? This means that N of t, the flux of neurons with this size, get bigger and bigger and goes to plus infinity at finite time. Okay? So when you see this, what can you say? You say, okay, with this equation, I cannot observe many patterns because either we have convergence to stationary states for excitatory case with B small enough and a well-chosen initial data, either we have blow up. So we want to eventually observe periodic solutions. Alors, so there is one way eventually to eventually observe a periodic solution with this kind of solution of equation. Sorry, is to try to define the solution after the blow up. So there are some authors that try to do this. So that's up here. So it's the work of Delarue, Anglis, Ribbenthaler, and Torre. But so it is probably work of with probability, and I don't think that they obtain the existence of periodic solution. But here are only no, I'm sure that it is not in fact. And so here I just concentrate on deterministic tools. So so what we have done? So okay, you cannot have theory on periodic solution, but at least we can study the stationary state and eventually the convergence to the stationary state. Okay, so the study of the stationary state, okay, we have an explicit solution here. With the mass conservation, we see that we have an implicit condition on the n infinity, the n infinity. And what we observe that in the inhibitory case, or if the excitatory case is small enough, B is small enough, we have a unique stationary state. For intermediate B, we can have at least two stationary states. And if B is large enough, there is no stationary state. And it is normal because if B is large enough, we have always blow up. And if we have always blow up, we cannot have stationary state. It's obvious. Okay. And okay, so with no interconnection, we have even better. With entropy type inequality, we can prove that the solution converges exponentially fast to its stationary state. So it's a work of Cáceres, Carrillo, and Pertam. So what we have done with Carrillo, Pertam, and Didier Smets is to consider the case, the non-linear case, because here b equals zero, it's linear. And what did we prove theoretically? So I don't here I don't put the proof, but I just give the results because the proof is quite technical. So in the inhibitory case, we have obtained a uniform estimate on the flux of the neuron independently of B. So it is important, and in of the initial data, it is important because when B is very large, even if B is negative, the nonlinearity is very strong. So this means it is difficult to tackle. Okay, so, but however, here we have arrived to prove uniform estimate on the flux of the neuron. So it is the first step to obtain eventually the fact that the stationary state is a global attractor. And it is the second point of our proof. So via essentially entropy method, okay, but I don't give the details, but we have proved that effectively we have a global attractor if B is small enough. So the fact that B is small enough is due to the fact that we can use here the entropy method only if B is not too large. Even if numerically we think that for all B negative, it is a global attractor. In the excitatory case, we have also estimates on n, but of course it depends on the initial data and on b, because if b is large enough or if the initial data is too close to vf, is too concentrated around vf, we have blow up. And we have shown the same kind of result, except that here we have not a global attractor due to the blow up, but we have a convergence to a unique stationary state for sufficiently weak interconnection if we well choose the initial data. So if the initial data is not too much concentrated near VF. Okay, so it is the case with without delay. So we say now what happens if we add delay? Maybe that with this we can have periodic solution. So now the n in here, instead of having n of t, I put n of t minus d, where d is strictly positive. And what we have proved with Cáceres, Roux, and Rickard-Schneider is that, of course, we lose instantaneously dynamics, so we have no more blow up. And we can even prove that we have existence and uniqueness of a global classical solution. And okay, and we also have exponential convergence to unique stationary state as soon be small enough. So that means that we are not too, we are close to a linear equation because b is quite small. Okay. So here I just give the idea of the proof of the global existence. So the first point is to make a change of variable to obtain a Stefan type equation and to obtain an explicit equation on the flux n. This allowing us with a fixed point argument to obtain a local existence. And after, to control the solution, we construct a super solution or an upper solution to obtain uniform estimate, après estimate on the flux n. And this will, and we will be able to conclude to a global existence. Now, okay. Now, if we say, if I ask, can we have now? Okay, the solution is well posed. Can we have a periodic solution on this equation? I don't know what you think intuitively, but if we assume that B is large enough, you remember that when we didn't have a delay, the solution always blow up, and in particular, we didn't have stationary states. So, and the second observation is that the stationary states of this equation with delay are the same as the stationary state without delay. Okay, because the stationary state and the independence of t. So this means now, okay, so this means that for large enough, b large enough, we know that we do not have a stationary state, and we also know that the solution is globally defined. So this means that at least we know that the solution will not converge to stationary state. So does this mean that we'll have periodic solutions? But in fact, okay, maybe naively we can say, okay, it's right, we have periodic solution. But it, in fact, it's not true. Because periodic solution, intuitively, we think that the periodic solution oscillates around stationary states. So here we don't have stationary states. So what happened in this situation for the excitatory case when B is large enough is that, in fact, we have some kind, so I made some simulation are here. We have no periodic solution, but the n of t, so here it's a variable t, here it's n of t goes to plus infinity when t goes to plus infinity. Okay, so we have explosion of the flux of neuron which discharge, but okay, we do not have blob. So we can, nevertheless, and we can observe some. It's not periodic, but you can observe some patterns which repeat but get larger and larger, and the length here seems to be the same. So they, okay, it's like you have some synchronization which get higher and higher. Okay, so unfortunately, even if we add delay in the excitatory case, we do not observe periodic solutions. So this does not mean that the periodic solution does not exist. Hein? This only means that here, with numerical simulation, we didn't observe it. But I think that there is no periodic solution. Hein? Okay, so, okay, it's in the excitatory case, we do not have periodic solution, but what happened in the inhibitory case? So in the inhibitory case, without delay, numerically, we observe no periodic solution, and we even observe that the solution goes very fast to its stationary state. Now, if we put a delay, we will observe interesting patterns. So I make, so I just to up put the equation that we observe. So here we assume that B is small, negative, and B very, very small, or the absolute value very, very large. Hein? Here, I put D equal 1 and VF equals 0 to do not have too much notations. So we have made some numerical simulation that I hope that Attends, je vais... I just put the numerical simulation. Je... OK. Hop. Partager l'écran. OK. Faire comme ça. Voilà. OK. And voilà. What do you observe? It's funny, hein? You observe some kind of Gaussian. We go from the left to the right. Okay? So the dynamic can seem very simple in some sense. So we say, okay, it's like a Gaussian. So here is the solution, okay? It's like a Gaussian. And when we have observed it numerically, we say, okay, maybe we can say something theoretically. So it's a current work. Hein? So, hop, 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 je vais juste faire partager l'écran. Hop. So it's a current work. So I just give the idea that we want to do. Hop. Okay. So we have seen numerically. We say, okay, maybe we can make some description theoretically. So what we have done, we have assumed that B is very, very small. So that means that we want to make an asymptotic analysis when we are in a very, very inhibitory case. And we have searched here, the solution, sorry, the solution of the form P of TV is equal to a function phi of V minus C of T, so like a wave which propagates from the left to the right, plus a remainder term, where the remainder term have to be very small. And we have proved that, in fact, this we can have the control of the remainder term with respect to the flux of neurons with discharge. And numerically, and we know that when B is very large, N gets very small. So we think that this kind of approximation is good when B goes to minus infinity. And we have searched the equation of C of T. We want that C of T is equal to C prime of T plus C of T is equal to B N of T minus 1. But heuristically, N of T minus 1 is minus DVP at VF. So it is minus DV of this quantity. Okay, and we put the remainder term equal to 0. So this means that asymptotically, we find that the speed of propagation from the left to the right satisfied this delay equation. So now the question is, does we have periodic solution of this delay equation? Because if we have periodic solution on this delay equation, and if the solution can be approximated by this quantity, whereas phi here is a Gaussian, then it's okay, we have theoretically proved the fact that the solution effectively have the dynamic of that we have observed numerically. And so what we have proved is that if B is small enough, then there exists non-trivial periodic solution of this equation. So the idea of the proof is inspired from Adler and Tomiuk. So it's essentially a study of the eigenvalues of the linear problem of this this equation with a good control. Oui.
Tu as 2 minutes.
Ah, I finished. Hein? I just finished. It's the end of my talk. And an application of the fixed point. Okay, so we have made numerical simulation. In fact, to compare, alors here it's the moment of the real solution of our equation. And here is the solution of the delay equation. Alors, so the problem is that here you see that it does not fit exactly, but the problem is that here we have chosen B equal minus 50. And when we study the problem, so I don't give the detail ici, here, we see that the judicious parameter is ln of B, of minus B. And ln of B goes very, very, very slowly to minus infinity. And it is very difficult to make to make simulation where when B is very, 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 very large, because the simulations are not accurate anymore. So okay, so we have, so we cannot numerically check our formally approximation, but at least for B equal minus 50, we see that it begins to look like, so the to be quite, depends of the interpretation, but I am quite happy of what happened here. So I thank you very much, and I finish my talk.
Alors. Thank you very much, Delphine, for your beautiful talk. Are there any questions?
Ah. Oh. No, it's okay.
So there's a question from Natalie Schieferstein. It seemed the periodic solution in your numerical simulation was a Gaussian traveling back and forth. Mm-hmm. If so, why? So why the Gaussian character?
Why the Gaussian? I I come back to here. I don't know exactly. I don't know explain it intuitively, but I come back to the slides.
There's an extension to this question. So why is it a Gaussian with a finite or with the constant width?
Sorry. Yes, I was.
Okay. So here, in fact, we have we have found the Gaussian only by making compute. Oh, in fact, all the computation here. In fact, I make one solution of this equation with here. I put it equal to zero, because n of t, when b is very small, n of t is quite equal to zero. Okay, and I inject this phi here, and we find that it is a Gaussian type, that phi must check a Gaussian equation. And after we compute the remainder term with respect to the Gaussian equation. In fact, we have inputted the Gaussian equation. So why exactly this is the case? It is because this kind of equation, we obtain some, if we put a zero here, the solution of this kind of type of equation is of Gaussian type.
Did you see the question? So Natalie is insisting about why the width is constant, and Etienne Tenré is also asking why, because we have a compact support. I mean, the V value is always bounded.
Ah, okay. No. Okay, because in fact, yes. Because what happened is we have compact support, yes, but when B is very, very negative, in fact, I put the equation on, you can put this equation on R by extending P equals zero on VF plus infinity. Okay, but when B is very, very small, in fact, on the solution defined on R is not equal to zero on VF plus infinity, but is very small. The Gaussian is very small, because the Gaussian is very, very from the left. So it's coherent that it is a good that it can be a good approximation, because the Gaussian goes very fast, in fact, from the left, and N of t is very small. So when you compare our approximation with a Gaussian which is defined on R, and the solution that we can project on R by putting zero on VF plus infinity, you can see that. But we don't have proof. Okay, we can see intuitively that it may be true. I don't know if it is clear. No.
Yes.
Yes.
Can I ask a short question?
Yeah.
Can you clarify? We are short on time, but can you shortly clarify what is the main difference to the classical work by Brunel and Hakim that you cited, where also the emergence of oscillation in this model with delay was analyzed.
Sorry, can you repeat the question, because I did not hear.
Can you hear me?
Yes, it's okay. Can you repeat the question, because
yes. So what is the main difference to the work by Brunel and Akim that you mentened, where they also studied the emergence of oscillations in the presence of delays and studied the Hopf bifurcation and made a weakly nonlinear analysis of this via the Hopf normal form and so on.
Yes. No. In fact, yes. They also study, in fact, numerically and make a bifurcation analysis on the case with delay. But I think that our study, so it's a work in the work is not finished. In fact, here what we have considered is the case very very inhibitory, and in fact the aim is to describe precisely the shape of the solution when B is very, very small. And I don't think that, from my knowledge, I don't think that Brunel and Akim, they prove periodic solution, they show numerically periodic solution and some bifurcation analysis, but I don't think that they put it like a Gaussian with a remainder term. And also, we have made a profile of the solution of this equation when B goes to minus infinity, of the periodic solution, because the theorem here give you existence of periodic solution, but you don't know the shape of the periodic solution. And here we have made some work that I do not mention here, but we have made a current work where we try to describe the profile of the solution when B goes to minus infinity.
Okay, and, thank you for your question. For your answer.
Yeah, so I think we have to stop. I'm sorry, Etienne, there was another question by Etienne, but I propose you to discuss about this entre vous.
Okay.
Not in English. So thank you again, Delphine, for your beautiful talk.